University of Florence. This work is a part of my PhD thesis. I will defend next Thursday. And it's a joint work with my two supervisors, Prof. Fabio Corradi and Michele Boreale, and with Antonietta Mira. In this work, our aim is to give a large deviation perspective on ABC, and we speculate that introducing an evaluation of the probability of rare event in ABC allows mitigating the problem of sample degeneracy in ABC. And in this talk, I'm going to start with a brief recap on ABC, just for set my notation, and then I will focus on the problem of sample degeneracy in ABC. Then I will introduce the theory of large deviation in ABC, starting from the simple case of IID data, and then extending our results to finite state Markov chain. And in the end, I will show you some simple examples. Further detail on this work are already published in a paper on computational statistics. However, part of the talk is composed of results in a working paper. And I want to point out that during this talk, I will focus on, in this work, we focus on discrete data. And on simple ABC sampling scheme, just for introducing this point of view on ABC. So in this case, we consider discrete random variables, and we assume that our discrete random variables are distributed according to a probability distribution P theta, and we assume a prior distribution pi. You know that when the model is complex, like you could be intractable. However, one can resort to ABC when is able to produce simulated data, pseudo data from a generative model. And in this case, one can implement a primal rejection ABC, whose output is a sample from the exact posterior distribution of theta and the pseudo data y given x. And this output is obtained by producing parameter proposal from the prior distribution, then simulating to the data from the generative model, and in the end by implementing a conditioning operation by retaining only those pairs theta and y such that the pseudo data y are exactly equal to the observed data. However, we know that this kind of algorithm is infeasible in a continuous setting or in a discrete high-dimensional setting. So one can introduce a two-fold approximation by comparing observed and pseudo data resulting to summary statistics to a distance function and a positive threshold. And in this case, the output of the algorithm is a sample from an approximate joint posterior distribution. And to get sample from the approximate posterior, one can simply disregard pseudo data. And in this expression, we can see that basically ABC approximates the likelihood by evaluating the acceptance probability, which is the expected value of the indicator function. So this is the object on which we are going to work in order to introduce an evaluation of the probability of rare events in the evaluation of the acceptance probability. Another common practice to replace the indicator function with a kernel function, which is defined on a compact support. And using a kernel function different from the uniform one allows for discriminating between pseudo data or pseudo summary statistics exactly equal to the observed data or just close enough, and allows for providing a continuous decay from 1 to 0 to discriminate between these two kinds of pseudo data. And you know, as epsilon goes to 0, the approximate likelihood converges to the true likelihood. And whenever one chooses sufficient summary statistic for the parameter theta, the output is a sample from the exact posterior distribution of theta given x. To get samples from the approximate posterior distribution, which is our target, there are a lot of sampling schemes. However, here we focus on important sampling, which is well suited for introducing our point of view. The output of the important sampling ABC is a weighted sample from our target distribution, which is the approximate posterior distribution. And this output is given by producing a parameter proposal from an important distribution on the parameter space, then simulating to the data from the generative model, and by giving to each pair theta and S of Y an importance weight, which is equal to the ratio between the importance, the target distribution and the importance distribution. So you know, in computing this ratio, the intractable likelihood cancels out, and the importance weight is equal to the product between the kernel function and the ratio between the prior and importance distribution. So one can see that in this case, the kernel function represents, is still defined on a compact support, meaning that when the distance between the simulated and the observed summary statistics exceeds the threshold epsilon, this kernel function assumes value equal to zero, and this corresponds to reject the parameter proposal. In fact, this kernel function defined on a compact support is the has an impact on the problem of sample degeneracy, which becomes more serious in the ABC framework than standard algorithms or important sampling algorithms. And it, generally speaking, the sample degeneracy arises when only a small fraction of the proposed values has relative high weights and leads to a low effective sample size, highly variable estimates. And in the ABC framework, could lead also to a bad approximation in the tail area. In a general framework, the clever choice of the importance distribution allows for mitigating this problem, or to overcome this problem, one can resort to a sequential method. However, in the ABC framework, we have an implicit rejection step based on the value of the kernel function. And for example, in this very simple example in which we have observed data equal to 14, assumed to be drawn from a binomial distribution with true parameter value equal to 0.7 and with n equal to 20. When one assumes a non-informative prior distribution, the true posterior distribution that exists and is a beta distribution. However, let's pretend that we don't know the true posterior distribution and that we are interested in getting a weighted sample from the posterior distribution through a standard importance sampling. In this case, by setting the importance distribution equal to the prior distribution, the importance weight will be equal to the value of the likelihood function. But let's now pretend that also the likelihood function is not analytically available and that we resort to an importance sampling ABC. In this case, the important sampling is more is a random weight important sampling, since we have that the importance weight is equal to the value of the kernel function, and the evaluation of the kernel function involves a random quantity, which is the value generated from the generative model. This means that when at a given iteration S, one proposes a parameter value in the tail area, for example, 0.42, in the standard importance sampling framework, one is able to give a positive weight to this full parameter proposal, which is equal to the value of the likelihood function. However, in the ABC framework, one needs to generate pseudo data from the generative model by giving this full parameter proposal as input to the generative model. And in this case, we get value equal to 9, which is far from the observed data and leads to an importance weight equal to 0, since the distance exceeds the value of the threshold. This means that this parameter proposal is discarded at all. So parameter proposals in the tail area really leads to observed pseudo data resembling the observed data. And in lack of accepted value in the tail area, the posterior distribution approximated by ABC, represented by the red line, results very concentrated around the true parameter value and fails in approximating the true shape of the posterior distribution. This basically is because simulating pseudo data equal to the observed data is a rare event. In fact, we can see that here in the standard important sampling, this value represents the an approximation of the acceptance probability in the ABC framework. In fact, one needs to simulate about 1,000 times 0.42 to get an approximation of this acceptance probability close to 0.008. And we want to speed up the evaluation of this acceptance probability even when this represents a rare event. So we introduce a rare event approach as in previous work, but here we consider the theory of large deviations, which allows for evaluating the exponential decay of the probability of rare event. And in particular, we adopt an information theoretic point of view by resorting to the method of types, which is an important tool in information theory and allows for computing some probabilistic results by shifting the focus from the observed data, the observed sequence, to its type, which in a statistical terminology corresponds to the empirical distribution. So the type of sequence is composed of the relative frequency of each possible value in the finite set on which random variables are defined. For example, given this sequence, the observed type, is composed of the relative frequency of 0.1, which is the relative frequency of A, 0.6, the relative frequency of B, and so on. This approach, based on the method of types, allows to get a very easy proof of the Sanoff's theorem, which is one of the major results in large deviation theory. And this theorem states that as m, which is the length of a sequence of IID random variables defined on a finite set, goes to infinity, the probability that the type is in a given set converges to this quantity, which is computed by evaluating the Kullback-Leibler divergence between the probability distribution P star, which is known as information projection, and the probability distribution P theta. The information projection basically is the probability distribution in the set B, which minimizes the KL divergence with P theta. This result can be used in the ABC framework when one summarizes data through the type. So one can choose a summary statistic, the type, and can define an acceptance region B composed of all types at a distance from the observed type smaller than epsilon. In this case, the Sanoff's theorem states that the probability of accepting a parameter value, which is the probability of simulating a pseudotype in the acceptance region, can be approximated using this quantity, which obviously still analytically unavailable since it involves the intractable probability distribution P theta. However, we prove that there is a valid asymptotic approximation for this quantity, which is obtained by replacing the intractable probability distribution with the simulated type. And this result is based on the fact that as m goes to infinity, where m is the number of pseudo observations, the pseudo type converges to the probability distribution P theta, and its information projection onto the acceptance region represented by this gray ball converges to the information projection of the probability distribution P theta onto the acceptance region. This result can be used in defining a kernel function, our LD kernel function, which assumes as the standard indicator function value equal to 1 when the pseudotype falls in the acceptance region, so when the distance is smaller than epsilon. However, it allows for taking into account the probability of the rare event when the type falls outside the acceptance region, involving the Sanoff's result. So we define a large deviation approximate posterior distribution, which relies on a large deviation approximate likelihood that can be taught as the sum between the approximate likelihood provided by a standard ABC algorithm and relying on the indicator function, plus an adjustment, which acts when the type falls outside the acceptance region. The way in which this adjustment acts in improving the approximation of the likelihood function depends on the value of the threshold m and on the number of sub-observation m. In fact, as m goes to infinity, the blue dashed line moves down, meaning that the exponential decay vanishes and the adjustment vanishes. We prove that in our paper, as m goes to infinity, the approximate likelihood, the LD approximate likelihood, converges to a standard ABC approximate likelihood. And we also show that types are always sufficient summary statistics for the parameter, meaning that as epsilon goes to zero, our LD approximate posterior distribution converges to true posterior distribution. And we also extended all the previous results to the case of data with a Markovian relation. Our extension is based on the use of the second order type, which is an empirical evaluation of the doublet probability distribution, that is joint probability distribution of the random variable at two subsequent states in the chain. So the second order type can be thought as a matrix in which each entry represents the relative frequency of a possible transition on the finite state. For example, given this sequence, we can see that we observe two transitions from B to C. And in the second order type, the entries corresponding to the second row corresponding to the value of B and the third column corresponding to C shows a value equal to 0.2, which is the relative frequency. And this is a graphical representation of the second order type. This allows for extending the Stanhope's results to the case of Markovian, to the case of finite state Markov chain. And here we have a result which is the analogous of the Stanhope's result, but we have the second order type in place of the first order type and the conditional relative entropy in place of the KL divergence, where the conditional relative entropy basically is the difference between the Kullback-Leibler divergence between two doublet probability distribution and the KL divergence between their respective marginals. So we extended our asymptotic approximation to the case of the second order type, and we provide an analogous of our LD kernel function in the case of Markov chains. To get sample in both cases, in the case of IID data and the case of Markov chains, to get samples from our approximate LD posterior distribution, we give an important sampling scheme, which basically is equal to the standard important sampling ABC algorithm. However, the indicator function is replaced by our LD kernel function. And this means that each pair have a positive weight, since this kernel function always assumes a positive value, meaning that we avoid the implicit rejection step in the ABC algorithm. And this leads to an effective sample size at least equal to the effective sample size provided by a standard ABC important sampling. We also give a Metropolis Hastings algorithm in which we replace the standard acceptance rejection step based on the comparison between observed and simulated summary statistics with use of our LD kernel function in the computation of the acceptance ratio. And we can see that also here, the rejection cannot be based only on the comparison between simulated and observed summary statistics. Just to recall the major drawbacks of the sample degeneracy problem, we now go to our examples, recalling that we want to evaluate the effective sample size, the variability of the estimate, and the quality of the approximation of the posterior distribution in the tail area. Going back to the toy example, we can see that the LD posterior distributions represented by the blue lines provide a better approximation of the posterior distribution than the standard ABC algorithms based on the indicator using the indicator function. And this is also shown by the mean integrated square error. We can also see that our LD algorithms lead to a greater effective sample size in both cases and to good performances in terms of approximation of the posterior mean evaluated through the mean square error. In this example, we have a mixture of binomial distributions, and here we have three parameters, lambda, theta 1, and theta 2. Here we compare the performances of the large deviation algorithm with the performance of the standard ABC by using the output of a Gibbs sample for finite mixtures as reference. And here I show the results for the parameter lambda, but the results for the other parameter are quite similar. To evaluate the rule of the parameter epsilon and the number of observation m, we implemented both the algorithms with four different pairs of the tuning parameters. And here we can see that as m increases from 500 to 5000, the blue lines representing the LD posterior distribution converges to the red lines representing the standard ABC posterior distribution. And we can also see that, in principle, one would expect that with small value of epsilon, both the algorithms, the standard and the LD version, provide a better approximation of the posterior distribution. However, the rejection ABC fails in approximating the posterior distribution with a very small value of epsilon equal to 0.005 due to sample degeneracy. And we can see that also the LD ABC fails in the case of a large value of M, but when one chooses a value of a smaller value of M, the LD ABC is able to mitigate the sample degeneracy problem and provide a good approximation of the posterior distribution, even when epsilon is very small. So the acceptance probability is very small. In fact, in the case of a small value of epsilon and a large value of M, also the LD algorithm has a very small effective sample size since the acceptance probability is very low. However, with M equal to 500 and epsilon equal to 0.005, the LD ABC mitigates sample degeneracy problem and leads to an effective sample size up to 10 times the one provided by the rejection ABC. The LD ABC provides a better approximation of the posterior distribution in all the four examples with all the pairs M and epsilon. And here we can see that the LD ABC outperforms both in terms of mean integrated square error and in terms of mean square error. We implemented also an example for Markov chains. Here, there is a simple autoregressive model in which the state of the chain is equal to the previous one with probability equal to lambda and to an innovation term with probability equal to 1 minus lambda, where the innovation term is a categorical random variable which has probability distribution equal to theta. And we set non-informative prior distribution both for lambda and for theta. Here I want to show that performances are better in the case of the LD than in the rejection ABC, but also that the LD ABC provide more stable a more stable estimate of the cumulative density posterior cumulative density function. In fact, here we can see the 95% bands for both the rejection ABC in red and the LD ABC in blue, which are computed by running 100 times both the algorithms. And we can see that the rejection ABC due to sample degeneracy has a very large variability around the estimate of the posterior CDF. To conclude, we can see that taking into account the probability of rare events resulting to large deviation theory provide a better estimate of the acceptance probability, and that method of types is a good tool for a smooth integration of LDT in ABC, and provides also a natural choice for the summary statistics, which are the types. The proposed kernel function is defined on a non-compact support and thus allows for mitigating the sample degeneracy, increasing the effective sample size, and improving the approximation in the tail area. However, our method still has a limited applicability, since we restrict ourselves to discrete random variables and to IID random variables and finite Markov chains, and extensions to other kinds of random variables or relation among random variables needs a more general result in large deviation theory. And we are also aware that there is the need for a more formal evaluation of the rule of M and epsilon and of an automatic or adaptive way of choosing the optimal pair M and epsilon. Here are some references, and thank you for your time.
Okay, thank you very much, Cecilia. So we have some time for questions. Would anybody like to ask any questions? Okay, so one thing that I wanted to ask is, do you think there's any hope of extending this to continuous data?
Yeah, obviously this extension is harder because we need to give up the method of type, and we need to rely on the Gatterellis, which is an extension of the Stanov's theorem for the more general results in large deviation theory. And but it is possible.
Okay, thank you. So Umberto Piccini has his hands up.
Hi, Dennis. Thanks. Thanks for the very, very nice talk. I have a basic question, perhaps, because it's at the very core of your talk. So I'm sorry if I misunderstood. But how do you compute, in fact, this the exponential of minus m times d? That d was related to the Kullback-Leibler divergence.
Yeah, your question is how to minimize the Kullback-Leibler divergence for compute the exponential, or?
I was actually interested in what was D representing, and so if you can go back for a moment to the slide,
yeah.
That would be easier, thanks.
Yeah, this one.
Yeah, so that was a Kullback-Leibler divergence, right?
Yeah.
And I was wondering, how do you compute that? I know that you said that it's not analytically computable.
This one is analytically computable because mm-hmm. this is the minimum KL divergence. Mm-hmm. So we need to choose in the acceptance region the probability distribution which minimize this distance, this divergence. Mm-hmm. And we, in practice, to minimize this quantity, we define a path from the observed type to the pseudotype by using the, sorry, maybe I have a slide to show this. Here. So we define the exponential eidetic, which is a path from the simulated to the observed type in a log scale. And these rely on this parameter. So to minimize this KL divergence, we need to just minimize with respect to this one, this parameter. And this is also a way to make this algorithm scalable with respect to the size of the finite set, because We don't need to minimize the distance in each point of the support of this probability distribution, but it is just needed to minimize with respect to this parameter to find the information projection.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks. I'll check the details in the paper. Thanks so much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, so we should move on to the next talk because we're trying to keep to time. So thank you very much, Cecilia.
Thank you.
There is some time at the end of the session if people have more questions, or you could also...